here in Usualandia. It's a collection of Commodore champions. As a follow-up to Computers of Significant History Part 1, I thought it would be fun to share some of my favorite Commodore 64 software and accessories. You might know some of them, and if you don't, you should check them out. The Print Shop. I've written a very long history of the print shop and its influence on computing in an old podcast. Perhaps I should remaster it and make a video? Broderbund's Print Shop is a contender for one of the top 10 most influential pieces of 8-bit software ever, and I spent a lot of time making birthday cards and school banners with it. It gave regular people a taste of what desktop publishing could do, and it certainly influenced my love of graphics. Castle Wolfenstein. I'm still playing Wolfenstein games to this day. While Wolfenstein 3D and its follow-ups are very different from Silas Warner's Castle Wolfenstein, this game cemented my ongoing love for the series at a very young age. Its control scheme was somewhat clunky, especially if you had the wrong kind of joystick, but it's still mostly playable. The game also taught me my first speedrunning trick. You can glitch doors that are near a wall to short-circuit the normal escape route. As far as the plot and bad guys, I had no context for the game's setting at the time. No one's teaching a 6-year-old about Nazis. It wasn't until years later, when Wolfenstein 3D was available on the Super Nintendo, that I started learning about the series' World War II inspirations. Kwik-Write. I used a lot of word processors on the C64, but Kwik-Write is the most memorable, because it's what I used to craft my childhood letters to Nintendo. To their credit, the game counselors at Nintendo answered every single one of them. Alas, all those letters, both to and from Nintendo, are long gone. It was more like a text editor than more powerful WYSIWYG word processors. It let me type words and send them to the printer, and that's all I wanted. As a grown-up, I'd find its limited formatting and lack of spell check infuriating. At least it had copy and paste. GEOS. The only application in GEOS that I used for any real amount of time was GeoWrite. Since it was a WYSIWYG word processor, it was much more powerful than programs like QuickWrite or Bank Street Writer, but it was glacially slow. By the time I had learned about fonts and good typography, I had access to better word processing tools at school, like Microsoft Word. But I still wanted to write things at home, and I tried really hard to make GeoWrite my main word processor. The last thing I ever wrote in GeoWrite was an essay for 6th grade history class about the Rosetta Stone. I only remember this because it was the same day as the debut of the classic Simpsons episode Summer of 4'2", May 19th, 1996. I took all day slowly writing the essay, in part because I was a procrastinating 13-year-old, and in part because GeoWrite was just so sluggish. I barely finished it in time to catch the episode premiere. From that point forward, any papers or correspondence would be written in something more modern, even if it meant staying after school to write them on a Macintosh. In retrospect, I appreciate the ingenuity required to make a GUI that could run on a Commodore 64. Ghettoblaster. Here's another game whose context was completely lost on me as a young child. What can I say? I was 5 and had no idea about the musical references. All I knew was that it was the boombox game. I returned to it over the years, getting better and better at the mechanics, but I never actually finished it. Turns out that was for the best, since the ending's terrible. Thank God it had one of the best soundtracks ever written for the SID chip. The main theme was a banger. The graphics are very nice too, considering the system's limitations. I'd take a modern remake of this in a heartbeat. 10th Frame and Leaderboard. I'm lumping both of these Access software titles together, even though they probably deserve their own entries. They have similar graphical and play styles. These were my dad's favorite games on the C64. I enjoyed them a lot too. The graphics in Leaderboard and its sequel were excellent for the time, and there was something fun about printing out your scorecard after a game of bowling in 10th Frame. All modern golf games owe a debt to Leaderboard, which pioneered triple-click swing control. Yes, I know about Mean 18, but from what I can tell in my research, Leaderboard beat it to market by a few months. Epyx and QuickShot joysticks. In our household, we had two kinds of joysticks. One was the Epyx 500XJ, and the other was the Spectra Video QuickShot 2. The former was designed to be handheld, while the latter attached to the desk via suction cups. Some games just didn't play well with the Epyx because it required two hands. The aforementioned Castle Wolfenstein was a non-starter, but I don't think there was anything better for rapid-fire back-and-forth movements required in some titles, like summer games. The QuickShot wasn't good for twitchy games, thanks to the longer movements required to engage its micro-switches. It had one helpful advantage if you needed to use the keyboard at the same time. The suction cups kept it in one place. Nowadays, these joysticks would annoy me due to their terrible build quality. Neither held a candle to an NES pad for responsiveness or toughness. If you want to see more chips and bits, make sure to subscribe to Userlandia on your platform of choice. Read the blog at userlandia.com and follow me on Mastodon at KefkaFloyd at bitbang.social. The Userlandia theme song is composed by Space Vixen, who you can follow at Space Vixen Music and listen to their music at spacevixenmusic.bandcamp.com. Thanks for watching, and we'll catch you next time here in Userlandia.